We seem to have lost the artiste. The artiste car is gone. They left at least 5 minutes before us.
Good evening, Andy.
Don't you know I'm still standing better than I ever did? Looking like a true survivor, feeling like a little kid. I'm still standing after all this time, picking up the pieces of my life without you on my mind. I'm still standing. Yeah, yeah, yeah. I'm still standing.
Zero, because I knew it was a really good album, and initially it did very, very well everywhere in the world apart from the States. Even though we'd had a top 10 single with I'm Still Standing, the album really didn't take off, and the record company in the States wanted to put out the fast tracks rather than the slow tracks to get FM play, which I'd been kind of short of for a time, and they followed it up with Kiss the Bride, which didn't do too brilliantly either. And funnily enough, the ballad sold the album in the States, and the album took off, and that was the icing on the cake last year, was the album actually finally selling in the States, even though it didn't really get into the top 20. But it's in the region of 800,000, 900,000 units now, which is fine for me. That's great, because I believed in the album. So with that album, things started to look up, and it really coincided with the get-together of the old band again, of Davey, Dee and Nigel, and then with Bernie, and we made that album, and we kind of had last year off. And I did a lot of promotion in Europe, because I hadn't really meant too much in Europe. And I've been trying to build that up for two or three years.
He has toured an awful lot in Australia and in Europe, which he didn't have time to do before when he was concentrating on the US tours. So I think that has given an awful lot of boost to his popularity in those countries.
And so we've solidified ourselves in Europe. And this year we've added another member to the band, Fred Mandel, who plays keyboards, because there's no way I could go on stage and play synthesizer. And we made this album without Fred, with just the other four people, other three people, and Bernie again. And to follow up Tula, I knew we were going to have to do a really fine album. And I've never felt so much pressure ever doing an album as I did on this one.
Contrary to what people probably believe, the thing is that Elton and I write all the songs as we record, which we did originally in the early days, and we've now started doing again. So the reason I went to Montserrat was so that I could write there, and when I came down there, I took a certain amount of material with me so that I could sort of basically get the ball rolling with him. And the way he does it, he gets up early in the morning, which is what you naturally do in Montserrat because the nights aren't too long there. And he starts working in the studio about sort of 8:30, 9 o'clock in the morning. And at that time, I start writing too. So we get somewhat of a little, you know, factory going. And so as I start finishing things, you know, he will start on them, and the songs will come up. And then, as people might know, he writes very quickly anyway. And so by midday, the band turns up. And we start recording, and you know, as we write, we record. So it really works like a little industrial line.
There's nothing much to do on Montserrat. It's a lovely island. It's fabulous. The people are wonderful. But really, there's all there is to do is to record. So consequently, it's a 10 till 8 o'clock in the evening job for us. And the studio is good too. I mean, you get used to a certain sound. I usually find that you can get, in that situation, you can get 4 or 5 albums or 3 or 4 albums out of a situation like that. We got 4 out of the Chateau, and I think we got 3 out of Caribou. And I think we're going to go back and do the next one, and might be our final one at air in Montserrat. Not because it's a bad studio, but because you can use a situation so much, and then it becomes too routine.
I love the Restless track, the opening track on the album, because I believe it says something. And although I'm not a great soapbox preacher, and I don't believe that should be done too much in records, I mean, I always think it's worth saying something if you believe in it. And I think I like that lyric probably the best on the album, not just because I think it's a great lyric, because it says something, and I think basically because of Elton's performance on it, it comes across as being very, very believable, and he does an incredible vocal job on it, and there's a great edge on it, and it you feel the actual restlessness in that track.
Yeah.
Misheard Again, which was a very country and western song, which I liked, but I knew somehow I didn't fit in with the rest of the album, and everybody else knew it but wouldn't say it to me, and I was in a snotty mood with Chris Thomas one day, who's the producer, at lunch, and I just came down and wrote Breaking Heart, sad songs, sat down, pressed the button on the drum machine, pressed the Yamaha, that was the sound, that was the rhythm, and just wrote it all the way through, I mean really all the way through. That's the first time it's ever happened, because usually when you write a song, if I write something all the way through, it's halfway, then I stop. And luckily, Steve, the tape engineer, tape op, had recorded it.
I've never been intuitive enough to pick singles, and when I have, I've always been totally wrong. But funny enough, I feel with sad songs, it was so instinctive. I think, without sounding too mechanical, I mean, I actually, when I sat down with the idea of that song in my head, I really think that I wrote it feeling a commercial element in the lyric. And when I gave it to him, I remember saying, hey, I think this one could be the one, you know, that's really going to pop out as a single, even before he'd written anything to it. And I went back to the house to do some work, and by the time I'd got back to the house, Elton was calling me on the phone saying, I've done it. So I think it probably breaks a record for the fastest song ever written. I think he probably wrote it in about 5 minutes flat, because that's about how long it took for me to get home.
And there it was, in 3.5 minutes, I had this song, and I knew that was it. And it's just one of those things, of all the stuff on the album, and there's some good great songs on it, I think this was the song that was going to be the single. It's very, very rewarding after all this time, and this is the 25th album, to actually get that enthusiasm and chemistry back. And not many people get that chance again, and we got it, and I'm going to capitalise on it.
The thing I've been realising on the last album, and on stage, the way we're playing now, is almost going back to the 70s, but with a more mature feeling towards it. So it's definitely the magic, I have to say it, yes.
I wasn't having fun at the start of the tour in Australia and New Zealand, because we were feeling our way, and to a certain extent we were in Europe. Until we suddenly had a band meeting one night. I'm not saying we were playing badly, I'm saying that it wasn't as good as it should have been with someone as talented as Fred Mandel in the band. And we had a get-together one night, and we all sat down, and I said, listen, this is not, we're not using Freddie Mandel as an integral part of the band, we're using him as a four-piece, plus Freddie Mandel playing the other parts. This is not the way that if we want to improve or turn the band in one final direction, that it's got to be. So, since that pep talk, we've been playing out of our skins, or we played out of our skins anyway in Europe. And because Freddie was eventually accepted as a member and not just an outsider playing the parts. And I think Freddie is the person that can switch this band into one final album that would go back towards the Tumbleweed days. It's getting funkier and funkier and funkier with Freddie.
It's a very, very close-knit thing, and we've been together for so long, I can't remember it, 14 years we've all been together. And it's great. There's nothing that can change it. It's like your brothers and your sisters travelling together. And, you know, if somebody has a bad day, everybody knows what each other are feeling, you know. It's from the heart, yeah.
It's interesting, when I'm at Elton's shows and I stand in the wings, I'm hit very hard by the emotion in some of the songs, and when I hear them sung again, not from the record but from the stage, I get new emotions put into them. I mean, recently, things that have really struck me have been things like, I think one of the best songs we've ever written is probably Candle in the Wind. I think of the recent things, I think Empty Garden is a very striking song. And then you go back to the early days. I'm not too fond now of some of our earlier stuff. I mean, it still remains very fondly in my memory. But I see the weaknesses in it now. I see the adolescence in it. So I tend to much prefer the latter songs now. I mean, on Too Low for Zero, I loved Cold as Christmas. I thought that was a real good song. I thought it said something very, I think it said something meaningful about relationships, it was one of the few songs that brings children into relationships. When people write songs, they tend to be very one-dimensional and forget that, you know, there are families now, you know. Maybe that's because I'm older now, you know. They're not teenage relationships anymore. So children do become involved, and so I thought that was interesting for that fact. And then obviously the body of work really on the new Breaking Hearts album is, I love all of it. I mean, you know, there's so much of it I like.
When I play some of the songs on stage, I'm suddenly beginning to realise, in the 79 tour with Cooper, I suddenly began to realise the brilliance of Taupin's lyrics. I used to be a melody man. Lennon used to say, I don't listen to words, I listen to the melody. Same with me. I see I had a record, if the melody gets me, that's it. The words can be anything. But on the 79 tour with Taupin, Taupin's lyrics, oh, I suddenly began to realise how good they were and what they meant. And I'm really actually only just starting to interpret his lyrics.
There have been some really great strokes. I mean, in the early days when, you know, doing a complete right turn from the Lush orchestral albums to Honky Chateau, I think was important. Changing the lineup in his band at various times. And I think more recently, when he went on the road with Ray Cooper and did a two-man show with himself and just a percussionist, was an amazingly brave thing to do. And it is remembered and will be remembered as one of the all-time great tours.
I'm the sort of person, if I'm working hard and I'm doing a lot, then it's good for me. If I'm sitting around doing nothing, then I tend to become very, very withdrawn, bitter, not realistic, not the real me, let's put it like that. I think if I'm doing something and I've got something on the boil and I'm working, then that's when my true talent and true personality comes out. There have been times in my life where I've been terribly, not through anything to do with music or football, but because of personal things, I've become very sort of withdrawn and bitter, and it has shown through my work and it's shown through my attitude, and I think it's been very bad for me, and I'll be the first to admit that. And it's easy to see which periods that's been if you look at it, sort of look at my work.
I don't think it's possible to push any major performer to do something that they don't want to do, and I think that the time has been right for him to go out and work, and he's enjoyed it, which is really the key.
I've just been very fortunate and very lucky. It's a matter of trust, and everybody, it's always a matter of trust, but luckily the people who've been around me, I think I've given them back. To get the best, you have to give the best, and I've always treated people fairly, and I've been very, very lucky, and it is so important.